For this video, we'll be describing our reactions and calculations for adding a strong base to a buffer solution. We're going to use sodium hydroxide in our example. We're going to stick with the same buffer solution, acetic acid and sodium acetate. So again, in our first beaker, we're going to draw 2 moles of our buffer solution. Again, the 2 is relatively random, enough to show the reaction, but not enough to overwhelm our beaker. So again, we have 2 of our weak acid and 2 of our dissociated salt. Those are the 2 parts of our buffer solution. And now in the right reactant beaker, we're going to put 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. Of course, we know that that completely dissociates. And like we did before, we now want to figure out what is the main reaction that's going to take place. So again, we can transfer over our spectator ions. We know that the 3 sodiums in these 2 beakers are just going to transfer over. They're not going to react with anything. They're all neutral spectators. We want to know when we add our sodium hydroxide to our buffer solution, what is going to react? Obviously, the sodium's not, so we need to figure out what is hydroxide going to react with. Well, since my acetates have a negative sign, make that one more obvious, we know that these are not going to react with each other. The acetates and the hydroxides will not react, right? They have the same charge. They're both bases. That's not going to happen. So we expect that the hydroxide will react with one of our acetic acids. Makes sense. The base will react with an acid. When this reaction happens, the hydrogen from the acetic acid will transfer to the hydroxide. So we're going to get 1 extra acetate ion, and we form some water in here. So that is the net reaction that's taking place. Of course, we still have all of the other components in here. We still have our 1 unreacted acetic acid, and we'll have 2 acetate molecules. So again, at the bottom here, I will write the molecular equation that takes place here. Again, when we're adding the strong base, that strong base is going to react with the acid part of our buffer, so the acetic acid, with some sodium hydroxide. We're still working with double replacement reactions. Since I have a strong base, this reaction is going to go to completion. I'm going to form more of the base part of my buffer and form a little water. And so again, on this slide, we've already described the upper half for the acid. Now we're looking at what happens when we add sodium hydroxide. Again, our molecular equation, that sodium hydroxide is reacting with the acid part of our buffer. This is going to decrease, and then we're going to form more of the base part of our buffer that will increase after reaction. So again, when we add strong base, the acid part of our buffer decreases, the base part of our buffer increases. So we're going to work through this problem. Again, since we're adding a strong base, we have a reaction that's going to go to completion, which means we need to use a change table. And so again, that description is here in this paragraph. Using a change table, again, I'm going to stick with using millimoles. So here's our change table. Again, on the second line is our molecular equation. And below each one, I'm going to calculate the millimoles to use. So again, for acetic acid, we have 0.50 molarity times the buffer solution volume, 75 mils. I have that same setup for the weak acid, the acetic acid. And again, both the acid and the base are given the same concentration. And so we're starting with the same amounts for both. That is not common. Usually these will be different starting amounts. Now my sodium hydroxide, again, I'm starting with 1 molar, 5 milliliters. And so I'm starting with 5.0 millimoles here. Again, I'm going to draw a squiggly line to separate my reactants from products. And I know that water will get formed, but because it's neutral, it will not affect our pH. So our next step is to determine what is our limiting reactant. Again, because we're using a change table reaction that goes to completion, we look for a limiting reactant. We compare the two amounts of our reactants, whichever one is smaller, is our limiting. It goes to zero, and that means we know the amount of change on our line here. Again, reactants decrease by that amount. The products will increase by that amount. That was an awful M. Sorry, this last unit is millimoles. Sorry about that. And of course, our last step then is to calculate the pH. Remember that because we're working with a buffer, we can leave our units in millimoles. As discussed in our acid example, we do not need to go back to concentration. Because everything's in the same volume of solution, if I were to convert back to molarity, it would all be in the same volume. But now I need to figure out what is my base and what is my acid. The sodium acetate contains my conjugate base. That's also a basic salt. And if you just use your nomenclature here, this of course is acetic acid. So my 42.5 is going to go on top. My 32.5 is going to go on bottom. And we get a final pH value of 4.86. That is correct for rounding. That is our final answer. So again, notice our pH went up a little bit after we added a little bit of strong base. So the next slide I have in here, again, just verifies the pH. Example 1420 for extra practice on adding a strong acid and strong base to a buffer. The last two notes that I want to make, the next slide that I have in here is great for practice. Your main practice questions are calculating the pH of an original buffer using formic acid now, adding some acid to it, and then adding some base. This problem in the middle I like to work though, because notice that the amounts I'm using here, I'm adding acid, but notice I'm now adding a lot of acid, right? 30 mils, 2.0 molar. And I'm not going to go into detail, but on the next slide, I do have the solution for this. So again, here's our buffer solution. We have formic acid and sodium formate. We're going to add HCl. And so that means this is our molecular equation, right? The acid, there's a plus sign in here. The acid reacts with the base part of the buffer to make salt and formic acid. We have our initial, change, and final. But notice what happens on the final line. Notice with the amount of the HCl that our limiting reactant is actually the base part of my buffer, which means at the end of solution or at the end of this reaction, I have HCl, which is a strong acid, and I have formic acid, which is a weak acid. I no longer have a buffer solution. This is not a buffer. I don't have a weak acid and its conjugate base in solution anymore. And so what it means is that the HCl is actually going to dictate my pH at this point. So to calculate pH, I know how much HCl is left unreacted. I would divide by my total volume of solution. So this is the volume coming from the buffer and the strong acid that are combined. There's my concentration, and I can calculate my pH. Notice my pH has plummeted here. This is not a small change. The original buffer would be a 4.14. This is now a drastic change. Lots of decrease here. That's a lot of down arrows, by the way. Just for the record, if I were to calculate the amount of hydronium from the formic acid, I only get this much concentration, 0.00887 molar. So relatively negligible compared to how much I get from the HCl. Either way, my pH is very low. I no longer have a buffer, and so we have a drastic drop in pH. The other thing to point out is that we can solve for the pH of a base buffer solution. So in this first question, we have an ammonia buffer with ammonium chloride. We, of course, are given the Kb of ammonia, right? The Kb of a weak base. And even though we have a base buffer, we can still use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. The difference is that we have to go through a series of steps to convert our Kb into our pKa. So remember, we can calculate Ka using Kw and Kb. Remember, Kw is 1.0 times 10 to the minus 14 divided by our Kb value. So we get a Ka for our weak base. And then, of course, to calculate the pKa, we would take the negative log of that value. And so our pKa here is a 9.25527. That's where this number came from. And again, we're still labeling. Our base is our ammonia that goes on top. The conjugate acid is the ammonium chloride. That's the number that goes on bottom in this ratio. So again, for a base, we can still use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation to calculate the starting pH. Makes sense that it would be higher because it's a base. I'll encourage you to practice calculating the pH after you add a strong acid. Are you able to write the equation for it and calculate this or determine the setup to calculate the pH? And of course, we expect our pH to decrease a little bit because we've added the strong acid to it.